so much. Thank you, Vidit. Thank you, Drishti, for joining us on this chat. We'll just keep it conversational.
Sure.
Try to learn more about your brands. And, you know, there are a lot of brands such as yourself who are here, a lot of founders. So all the insights you share will be amazing. So to start with, you know, I would like to learn a little bit about your journey. You know, if you can tell me a little bit about where this started, where you are right now, and if there is any key milestones that you have achieved that you want to talk about and highlight.
So we are also a COVID baby. When COVID happened, we realized the importance of self-care. We are building a well-being and healthy platform called Kind Life. It has two aspects to it. One is commerce. So we try having all the brands which are toxin-free in nature. Broadly, there are three categories: in the body, on the body, and around the body. In the body is functional food and beverages, nutraceuticals, supplements, and on the body is BPC, hair care, skin care, makeup, cosmetics. And around the body is things like home essential, mom and baby care product. And then we have a second aspect to it, which is community. What we realize is there were a lot of conversations which were happening on social media around well-being, self-care, but those were all one-way conversations which were happening. And brands were talking to the customers directly, but customers were not able to interact them back. So that's how we thought of building a community along with the e-commerce angle to it. When we started in 2022 of January, that was our first month. The journey has been really, really good and lot of ups and downs for sure. But when we started, it was more about Indian brands, Indian D2C. But over the period of time, we realized that Korean beauty is doing really good in India. And we are one of the largest and most loved when it comes to Korean beauty in India. And we have been able to get around 80 brands right now in India.
Wow.
With respect to Korean beauty. So it's been 2.5 years to us. Good journey. And our key milestones will be that we just raised a Series A round.
Absolutely. And Vidit, it would be interesting to understand, while you have Korean beauty as a major attraction on your platform, beauty and wellness has been one space that has been emerging and growing ever since COVID happened, right? And we learned and appreciated to take care of ourselves. So, and there are a lot of brands in the space. So what is that mantra, if I may call it so, to stand out, you know, that your customers come to you and not the others who have similar offerings?
I think you have to be true to yourself and true to the customers on what you are offering to the end user. Our mantra has been very clear that we are building for Gen Z. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to Gen Z, they are both value conscious and value driven. So whatever they apply or use, consume in for their body, they are very, very, they ensure that whatever goes, it's absolutely correct, right? So our mantra has been that we have been building something for Gen Z.
Sure. Thank you. Very insightful. Drishti, same question to you, and I would have the same follow-up about, you know, clothes also, where you cater to your audience, is something that we have a lot of options on, right? Every other day we have a new platform coming up with clothes offerings. So one is, help us understand a little bit about your journey, and two is, how do you stand out?
Thanks, Tasmay. Hello everyone, post-lunch session, I know, but let's go back to today morning, and how many of you were thinking about what do I wear to this session this morning, like, or to wherever we go, like, can I have a raise of hands, like, main aaj kya pehnu? Yeah, I know, yeah. So most of us think that, and that's how I got the idea of Let's Dress Up, of how important dressing up is to each one of us. Not to forget that it's more important for women, right? So I am Dr. Drishti Anand. So yes, I am a doctor turned entrepreneur and a fashion entrepreneur. So that's been my journey in one line. So when I faced the hassle of finding the right fit in the right style for myself, that's when I kind of ventured into the space, because at Let's Dress Up, for me and my team, we are true believers of the power of dressing up, of the confidence it instills in you, especially women when dressed up right. And that's how I kind of entered into the venture of building Let's Dress Up, also called as LDU, wherein we are building the most inclusive fashion company for women of Bharat. I say Bharat not because I'm a Modi fan, but because Bharat is actually the mainland of India where we have the maximum population staying,
sure,
not just the first, you know, 8 to 10 metro cities or so. And by inclusive, I mean for all, from sizes, be it extra small to 8XL, and you will find these sizes never out of stock, and they would be available across all styles, across a similar price range. So there is no so-called fat tax. And therefore, we are building on the core principles of inclusivity, wherein we want to take everybody, empower every woman in any nook and corner of the country, and also inclusivity, like I said. So that's been my journey today. We have, today, 19 September, LDU celebrates its 5th birthday, actually. So my team is waiting there with a cake, but thank you. We've almost served, you know, around more than 1 lakh consumers, covering absolutely D2C, covering more than 7,000 PIN codes across country. So that, I think, is one of the milestones I have achieved. That's a bit about LDU and myself. Talking about the your second part of the question is, you know, how do we stand out? I think in one word, I would say, if you're building a business, be it anything, if you have to stand out, your focus is very important. And at no time, you know, you can afford to lose that focus. And there are many brands, abhi ye nahi chal raha to theek hai, men's wear kar lete hai, ye nahi chal raha to kids wear kar lete hai, ye nahi chal raha to accessories kar lete hai. So you spread yourselves so thin that ultimately you lose focus on where am I supposed to channelize my energy. So I think we have always been very, very focused. That is number one. And secondly, fashion mein jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So be very aware, put your ears very close to the ground of what your consumers are actually looking for. And if you can create a deja vu moment for the consumers when they look at your product, well, I don't think there's anything stopping you from growing.
Awesome. I will come back to you with another follow-up question. First of all, happy half decade to your brand.
Thank you.
And you know, you spoke about customers and understanding their pain points, catering to them. So where does this discovery happen? How do you as a brand, you know, acquire customers, and not just acquire them, make them stay? How do you build that brand loyalty?
So I think when it comes to consumers, I always stress upon one fact, is about staying very close to them and knowing what's going on in their mind, irrespective of what I like, irrespective of what my designers would like to launch next. It's important to know their needs. So when we talk about, you know, this balance of what the consumers like and what you want to make, I would say on the consumer side, it's very important to have a continuous feedback loop. Now, this feedback loop for us, you know, would run between zero party data, which is data which you get directly from the consumers. You have data from your website, which is your first party data, and then third party data. It's absolutely open out there. It just depends on how beautifully you can use that to, you know, nurture insights and inculcate in your building, in your innovation. And at the second hand, when you're trying to build certain products, agility is very important. You need to know that, especially in a category of fashion where today something is trending and, you know, next month something else, you should be agile enough to introduce, innovate, iterate very, very fast.
Sure.
And I think that is one way of making customers come back to you, because if you're a woman yourself, when we go out shopping, I've usually heard women around and also, kuch aur nahi hai, bhaiya kuch naya dikha do. You show them 100 colors, they say, aur color nahi hai. So that is the insight which has come, that you always want to see something new, right? So at LDU, we have designed our system in such a way that we launch new products every week. So that's one of the channels to acquire customers and also to retain them. Because whenever they come on to your website, to you, or they meet you on your social media, they have something new. So aapko kabhi na kabhi apne liye kuch na kuch to milega hi. So that is how you maintain the cycle of acquiring them and then obviously retaining them. Retaining customers, I will also add 2 points. One is product quality and your service to the consumers. Because most of us, if you look at a new brand on social media, which is the, you know, the so-called 99% discovery happening on social media, you would first like to go and check out ki ye sahi hai bhi ki nahi hai, is it a fraud, mere saath mera paise to nahi chale jayenge. I mean, we sitting in Delhi NCR might also not think so much, but imagine a woman sitting in a tier 2, tier 3 city, she would be super skeptical about what this brand is all about. So thereby building credibility, keeping your product quality very high, and also offering a service which they can never forget will help you retain them.
Great. And picking up from that, you know, product quality, service, something new. How would you add to that?
I think customer delight is the most important thing when it comes to any service company or a product company. So at our end, what we're trying to do is we have built a lot of AI tools to handle customer support. Earlier, we used to have a team of 10 people who used to listen to all the complaints. Now, what we have done is we have automated a lot of things using AI. And secondary, whatever. So in our case, we source all the products directly from the brands. And we make sure that the end user gets the authentic product and there are no high copy or fakes happening. So that's how we kind of maintain the trust of the end user in our products.
Right. Coming back to you, Drishti, again building on the same point, you were talking about something new, about what consumers want, you know. So that's what I want to understand. Where is the balance between innovation, feedback and creating new products for your consumers? And what is the metrics that you use internally at your brand to gauge the success of this innovation or this new product launches that you keep having? Because you mentioned, you know, coming up with something new is the essence of it. So how is the measurability there?
So I think key metrics which we kind of identify or we kind of keep a track very closely are one is NPS, that is the Net Promoter Score. So we capture it at every level. So there are transactional NPS, which means while you're shopping on a website, which is absolutely transactional. You don't know me, I don't know you, but how was your experience on the website? Then you go on to other service, which are also transactional NPS, wherein things related to delivery. And then you have the actual relationship NPS, when the actual product reaches you, when your actual service reaches you. So we kind of track that at every level, at every product level, to identify where, you know, there are crests and troughs and where we need to make that changes. That is a very important metric. Secondly, return rates are very important. How many consumers? So basically, you could track it in the form of monthly retention rate, which is how many consumers come back to you, buy again. And on the long run, to actually see LTV to CAC is one of the most reliable parameters. So those two parameters we actually see. Return rates are very, very high in terms of fashion. I would probably say I have a return rate less than 4%. And that is primarily because, you know, we have the ability to iterate very, very fast. And this is what is the answer to your first question of how do you balance between the consumer demand and what you can produce. If you have a supply chain which is agile, you can definitely bring changes in it. And that is what, you know, fashion is all about these days, to bring newer things to people. It may not work, that is all right. But you should have the capability of rectifying that as soon as possible. And it's not going to hurt your pocket, your bank balance or anything. So being agile is very, very important.
Vidit, I will come to you with the same question, but with a little bit of tweak. As a consumer myself, I know return rate on beauty is high. Some onion, some garlic, some ingredient somewhere has worked for me, and I want that brand. So I think that is a little bit taken care of. But for beauty, again, experimenting is a thing, right? If I'm using one brand for the past 5 years, I might not be open to trying a new brand, which might be better, but I do not know about it, right? So help us understand, how is the acquisition happening, getting new customers on board?
So we very early in our life cycle realized that Meta and Google will kill you when it comes to CAC. So what we have done is we have created a pool of 5,000 influencers. These are nano micro influencers which we work with. What we have done from our end is that we have created a dashboard for them. where we share all the products, upcoming brands, deal offers with them, and they can create their own store content using AI as a tool on our platform. So they act as a brand ambassador, and the good part with them is that they are nano micro influencers with sub 10,000 followers on their social media handle, but they have a very large community on a WhatsApp or on a Telegram or on any other channel. So let's say if I kind of say some product to my friend, recommend some products to my friend, they are more inclined to buy it, right? And same case is with these nano micro influencers, wherein they, when they pitch a product to their user, they are more inclined or more they kind of get converted better than what other influencers does for us. Secondly, what we also realize that because people have been in the earlier days, content was not available for everyone, right? Reliance Jio basically has made sure that internet is with everyone in India. So people are very aware of what is happening around the world. So they are very, very up to speed or up to date what trends are there, what is happening in the market. So we also try to work with our influencers and be up to date with the trends and brands and products. So we keep offering them new brands/products. And with Gen Z, what they have started doing is that now earlier there used to be 2-3 products, right? Red lipstick hota tha, ya ek oil hota tha, ek cream hota tha, Fair and Lovely. But now people have started doing 5-step morning routine, 7-step night routine, right? And what they've started doing is there is no one brand which will fit into 5-step routine. There will be multiple brands and multiple products, right? So which kind of helps us for also to give more options to the end user.
Give us an honest answer. Do we need a 5-step routine or sirf moisturizer se chalega?
So I personally don't do any 5-step routine, but there are people who kind of follow it, and it is working for them.
Right. With that, you know, Drishti, I would come to you with an interesting question that we have been discussing with a lot of emerging brands, new brands. At what point in your journey do you start working on building branding, a brand awareness, your brand recall? And how does it balance with, you know, working on your ROI? Where do you set the right balance? And at what point in your journey did you personally start working on building a brand?
Day one.
Okay.
So I think all of us kind of, like even your question suggests that there's a particular time when we have to kind of start ki aaj main branding kar rahi hu ya kar raha hu. But it doesn't happen like this. Brand for me is an emotion. Mm-hmm. To connect and how it flows on to your audience, and it will start flowing from day one. So we need to be very careful about what the communication is to your target audience from day one itself. And when it comes to a question like when do you actually start branding is day one, but when do you actually start increasing your spends to actively
Absolutely.
Start branding is another question. That totally depends on your on how healthy your unit economics are, to be very honest. But I think it starts from day one. And there are certain aspects of branding, your product, your proposition, and your product quality, and how it is placed. So for me, if that product and proposition are very right, the communication is the same across channels. Right? Branding is done from day one. And wo ROI mein hai, wo ROI mein nahi hai, us samay starting mein aapko pata nahi chalega. But eventually, after 2 years when you talk to your consumers, then you come to know that yes, I have left an impression there on their minds that they remember this name. So it's a very crude example coming to my mind. I walked into a family gathering, a new gathering, new side of people I had to see, and they say, "Acha, acha, acha, aapka wo brand hai jisme ek hanger hai." So I was shocked. I mean, I didn't even think about branding at the time I designed this logo, but it's now imprisoned in their, you know, on their minds that okay, there's a hanger in the brand, and that's how it goes. So it starts from day one. So eventually, whatever you're communicating, whatever you are putting forward, you need to start thinking ki this is going to be from day one, and the ROI is going to be significantly higher 5 to 10 years down the line. That's when you kind of build ki, you know, that customer brings that comes back to your website or your social media, or you know, you kind of bump into them in some market. So that's the beauty of branding.
With the same question to you, did your branding also start on day one, or
I totally agree with Drishti that branding starts from day zero, right? When we think of the name of the company, which will go out to the end user, when we design the logo. So even before the website or the retail shop is being made, the logo of the company or the name of the company has been decided. So it starts from there. But to add on to that, I think it also depends on the life cycle of the company or the brand where they are. Whatever communication we do to at any point or at any channel, branding is an integral part of it. But if you have to scale from, let's say, 1 to 2, then we might not spend a lot of money on branding. But if you have to scale from 1 to 10, then branding should be the core, which will take you to 10.
Perfect. And you know, brand stories can go on forever, but our time is up. And I'll just ask one closing question, start with you, Drishti. In the next 2 years, where do you see your brands, and what are the milestones that you're looking to achieve?
I see every woman wearing Let's Dress Up and feeling absolutely comfortable in my outfits, and I challenge you all, you would be buying them soon, all the women out here, not men, or maybe men for their better halves. So basically, we want to be the go-to destination for comfortable fashion, so that any woman in any size and any style gets to wear her confidence at a very, very affordable price. That's what we achieve to be in the next 2 years, and the name Let's Dress Up to be remembered for that particular thing. If that answers your question.
Perfect. Vidit, you.
So in next 2 years, we want to own Korean culture and Japanese culture in India. So we want to be known for whatever Korean fashion, beauty, skincare brands. If anyone wants to buy anything Korean, it has to be us.
Perfect. So next 2 years, we are coming back in your clothes and with Korean glass skin.
Sure.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Vidit. Thank you so much,
Drishti,
for this amazing session.
Thank you.